Hello, and welcome to On Your Screen, a podcast dedicated to digital film culture and a companion to the Video Essay Podcast. I'm your host, Will DeGravio, and my guest today is Anthony Hahn, the curator and creator of the popular Twitter account Dancer on Film. One of the goals of this show is to get behind the veil, so to speak, and get to know the people behind some of the most popular pillars of the online film community. On today's show, Anthony discusses his curatorial approach, how he thinks of his Twitter account as a gallery, and his passion for the musical genre. Now, before we get to our conversation with Anthony, a friendly reminder to please visit the podcast's website, www.thevideoessay.com. Follow the show on Twitter, @thevideoessay, and please subscribe to the show's relatively new YouTube page, The Video Essay Podcast. You can also subscribe to the show's newsletter at www.thevideoessay.substack.com. Please also consider leaving a 5-star rating and review on iTunes or wherever you listen to your podcasts. And now, without further ado, here is my conversation with Anthony, the creator of @DancerOnFilm. To be joined by Anthony Hahn, who is the curator of the very popular Twitter account Dancer on Film. If you are at all connected with the film Twitter universe or the cinephile landscape out there online, you've undoubtedly encountered Dancer on Film, the account. And so I'm very excited to have Anthony on to get a look at the person behind the Twitter account and to learn the history of what really is for me a staple of film Twitter and an account that I really gained so much from. So, Anthony, welcome to On Your Screen. It's such a pleasure to have you here.
Yeah. Hi, Will. Thanks for having me.
Yeah, no. Thank you. And, you know, as I was mentioning to you earlier, on the last episode of this show, we had on Don McGowell, who is the curator of the Twitter account Silent Movie Gifts. And obviously your account and his account are different in many ways, but they're, I see them connected in that I'm personally interested in thinking through digital film culture and how moving images circulate and are shared on Twitter. So in many ways, I see our conversation as a follow-up to that conversation. So if you're here because you're interested in Dancer on Film, I would encourage you to go back and check out that earlier conversation as well. But first, very basic question is, give us an introduction to you and a sense of who you are, your background, and what prompted you to start this Twitter account, Dancer on Film?
Yeah, so, my name is Anthony, but people probably better know me as Dancer on Film through the Twitter sphere. And what I do is basically essentially like collect and post clips and GIFs of dance scenes from various movies. Like, if I'm being completely honest, like, it's quite difficult for me to recall why exactly I started the Twitter account. Like, I started it just over 5 years ago. And like before I started the account, I had like another Twitter account where like I would like post about film and I had like a film blog. And I guess like when I was browsing, I saw like an opportunity to create this something that hasn't been done before. And I basically just started thinking about what I could do that's kind of unique. And so that's why I basically just started collecting these dance scenes. So I think I mainly like just kind of started on impulse. Like when I started, I had like little idea of where I was going to go, what I was really going to do with it. So I was like very unorganized at the start, but like very, very unlike what I am like now. Yeah, well, I think when I first started, it was just very different to what has become now. And like when I first started, I even had like a different profile name as well. But I don't actually remember what that was. But I think it was just something almost kind of pretentious. But then like, I simplified the name and like, Dance on Film is just very clean and simple and like straight to the point, which I like.
And what was it about, you know, dance? It, clearly you have this interested, you have this broad interest in cinema generally. What is it that drew you to the dance scene in particular? I mean, of course, there are just so many to choose from, and there are so many wonderful examples. And I think of the dance scene as such a great choice because there's just so much movement and choreography and different styles and traditions. But what is it that draws you to dance scenes in film?
Yeah, so I really have like no background in dance at all. Like, I can't dance at all. But I think it's just something, there's something just incredibly joyous about watching people dance. It's like very like beautiful to watch. And like you've just watched like the old classic Hollywood dance scenes and musical numbers, incredible and amazing. And I also think like the musical is a very maligned genre. Like, it doesn't command much respect, like even for like modern cinephiles. Like, even if they're interested in old Hollywood, they're probably more interested in the dramas or like film noir. I wanted to bring more respect to that genre and like celebrate some of the more unknown dancers from that period. So like my main interest was very much in old Hollywood when I began, but it's kind of expanded and been more broad since.
And so did you have a pre-existing expertise or interest in the old Hollywood musical and dance on film in general, or did you sort of learn and develop this interest throughout the course of creating the account and growing it?
Yeah, I think it's a bit of a mixture of both. Like, I'm definitely not an expert in the movie musical, and that's not me trying to be modest or anything. I really am not. But like, I think I've seen like a good amount. So I've seen enough to like have a good knowledge about that period. But like, I don't think of myself as specializing in any area of film. Like, I do watch, I try to watch a broad range of cinema. And as I've kind of continued with this Twitter account, I have definitely learned more. I've definitely learned a lot more from like different countries as well. Like, since I started the account, like, I learned more about like Brazilian musicals of the 1950s and like Turkish musicals. Like, I'm very lucky that I have like a worldwide following. So sometimes like people would DM me with dancings from their country, and it's like something new and I haven't seen before. So I'm very lucky to be always learning and discovering more.
And I want to get back to that because I love this, you know, the audience interaction that you have with the Twitter account. And I want to definitely talk about that more. But what led you to choosing Twitter as the medium for the account? Clearly, you had mentioned that you had a blog and that you had other Twitter accounts. And again, you're, for those who aren't familiar with Dancer on Film, you're primarily sharing short video clips or scenes of dance scenes. And so you could imagine something similar on YouTube or Facebook or even, you know, Reddit or Vimeo or something, or Instagram. What led you to choosing Twitter? Was there something specific about that medium that you felt would be ideal for the kind of account and work that you wanted to be doing?
To be honest, Twitter is just something I was just familiar with. So I don't think I've ever really considered another format. Like, after I started my Twitter account, I did briefly had also an Instagram, but I just found it kind of pointless to have like two different accounts. And like, Twitter is just very easy to use, and like, things can be shared very easily and liked very easily. So I just never really considered anything else.
How have you seen the account grow over time? Is that something that happened very organically? Do you have a strategy?
Yeah, I think my account kind of started quite slowly, to be honest. Like, I only, like, even from very early on, like, I only post like 3 times a day. So it's like, I do have very minimal interaction in that respect. But it's just been like a slow build up, and once it gains momentum, the momentum just becomes bigger. Like, I think within the first year, I only had like, I don't know, maybe 10,000 followers. So it's definitely like building momentum, as I said, and like it took me a very long time to like even get 1,000 followers. And it like always helps like whenever like somebody famous like retweets one of my tweets. Like I think one of my like first like famous directors to retweet one of my tweets was Ava DuVernay. And like whenever like somebody famous retweets something, you always get like a large following straight after. So those things kind of helped. I just think I've just been very consistent. Like, you know what to get from this account. It's very straightforward. So if people like it, then they just follow us.
That makes a lot of sense. And I like how you say that, you know, you kind of know what you're getting with the account, which I think is so crucial, because I think, you know, a lot of times people, maybe they try to start some sort of podcast or blog or website, and they try to make it really large and all encompassing. And sometimes it's harder to find an audience or and really engage people when you're so broad. And it seems like you subscribe to that theory. Like, I'm just going to drill down on this one aspect of filmmaking and really just dedicate myself to that portion. You know, when we think about the history of dance on film, I think probably my favorite musical, or one of them, is Swing Time, the great musical with Fred Astaire and Ginger Rogers. And if I remember correctly, I believe you recently celebrated the 5-year anniversary of the Twitter account, and you posted that your first tweet was that great dance scene between Fred Astaire and Ginger Rogers in that film, where he's kind of just come into this ballroom dancing studio that she's working at, and she's about to get fired because he's been a jerk and whatever. And then he kind of saves her job and says, "Hey, look, this is what let's show them what we've been working on." And then they do that great dance number. That is obviously an iconic scene. So perhaps the answer is pretty simple, but what led you to choose that scene, as your first tweet, or the way to kick off this project?
I can't recall like my exact reasoning. But if I remember correctly, when you think of like movie musical stars, I think the first two names that usually pop up is Gene Kelly and Fred Astaire. So like, I think I was always going to start with either one of those two. And I believe at the time my profile image was of Gene Kelly in Singing in the Rain. So, you know, I decided to go with Fred Astaire for my first tweet. And you just can't go wrong with a good Fred Astaire and Ginger Rogers like scene. So yeah, and like Swing Time is basically I think is probably my favorite Fred Astaire film, possibly alongside Top Hat. So yeah, it was just the one that immediately popped into mind, and it's just like a really great scene. Like you said, it's like full of energy and it's a lot of fun, and it's just like a really like joy to watch. And yeah, that's basically it. And also, even though I said like I celebrated my 5th anniversary with a clip from that film, like when I originally started, I only actually started with GIFs. So I didn't actually post the clip of the film. It was actually just a GIF of Fred and Ginger dancing. And I don't know what precise moment it is, so I just don't remember it. And unfortunately, like the file's done gone, but I do remember it was from that scene.
That actually leads perfectly to my next question. So I didn't know that you had started off by posting GIFs and then making your way. Now, you still post GIFs on occasion, I know, but I primarily associate your account with short videos, often a full scene or a significant portion of the scene. When did you make that transition and why? You know, was there something about the short video that captured these dance scenes in a way that you felt the GIF didn't? Could you walk us through that change and why you started doing that?
It just came from like osmosis, I guess. Like, I basically started with GIFs just because that's how I envisioned my account initially. But then it just became very obvious that I should start posting clips. Like the addition of sound, and obviously like you could post long clips as well, which is an obvious advantage. So it was just a very obvious thing to do. Like I think I started like exclusively GIFs for like the first 2 months, and then I transitioned into clips and GIFs. And during that time, like this was in 2016, so Twitter only allowed like 30-second clips during that time, which has some advantages and disadvantages. Like I quite liked that time when I had just a 30-minute snippet, because I'm a 30-second snippet, because it's like, then like I kind of have envisioned that I would never post the same clip twice, because like if you have like a 3-minute dance scene, then you could just chop up those are different ways, and then I'll never have to post the same thing twice, and just be always, I'll always be posting unique things. But instance, it's expanded to 2:20. Like, I feel like I might as well post as much of the dance sequence as I can.
That's fascinating. And it's, you know, it's kind of what you say is such a, you know, something we talk about so often in on my other podcast, the Video Essay Podcast, and also in the creation of art generally, which is that constraints and limits are often really helpful in producing new things. And so how would you go about, you know, it's hard to imagine only being able to watch 30 seconds of Gene Kelly and Singing in the Rain or something. And so when you were beginning, so, you know, even though you are just taking a clip, a lot of thought goes into that, you know, where are you going to cut? What 30 seconds are you going to highlight? What are you going to share? How would you make those decisions? Like, how would you think about it when you were essentially narrowing down a dance scene to 30 seconds to reach an audience? Like, could you walk us through your thought process there?
I think at that time, I would just generally just think of what part contains the most like extravagant like scene, like what are like extravagant 12, something really flashy or romantic. Like even now, I actually have to think about where to cut, because like a lot of, because of the 2:20 limit, there's a lot of, if not a lot of musical sequences do extend beyond that. To like, the best thing to do, I feel, is to limit my thought process. And to make things easier for me, I generally have a rule of taking the end part of a musical dancing, because generally I feel like the flourish at the end is worth keeping. And also, you never want to like cut midway in a dance sequence. Like, I feel like that's taking away something. I still have to make that judgment. Sometimes I do have to cut midway. Like if I feel like there's a good point to cut, but generally I will try to, like if I have to make a decision, I would rather cut the beginning of dancing rather than the end. And like there is still like advantages to like the GIF format as well, because sometimes like there could, like I generally have my GIFs at 6 seconds long, and there will be sometimes just like something very cool in 6 seconds that I could tweet out. Or even like there could be like just one dance that could only last for like 6 seconds, which fits perfectly in GIF format. For example, like in the end of To Have and Have Not, when like Lauren Bacall is like shimmying her way to Humphrey Bogart, and it's just such a smoldering, such a beautiful like scene. And That fits perfectly into the GIF format.
Going back earlier, you mentioned that followers of the account will often share their favorite films or encourage you to, you know, watch films from a different tradition or a different part of the world or what have you. And could you talk generally about how you select the films that you feature? Because you really are a curator of this material of sorts. And so what is your general philosophy and approach to how you find films to share, and when and how you share them?
Yes, so I do like a lot of planning with my tweets. Like I schedule like, well, I don't schedule, but I like plan like 6 weeks in advance in general.
Wow.
Like I like to have a good idea, because like I'm very focused on the idea of curation. It didn't used to quite be like this, because like when I began, I thought of my account as more of an archive, and that will just keep building. But in 2019, I was suspended from Twitter, and thankfully I was reinstated. But after that, because of copyright, and after that, I basically changed the way I did my Twitter account, because I basically erased everything I had and decided to start from scratch and focus on that idea of curation. So like nowadays, I delete my tweets after like 30 days or so, and that's to protect me from copyright, but it's also just to emphasize that this is like the state of films. So kind of like think of my account as kind of like a gallery that's always in rotation. And so when something new goes in, the old things go out. I like when I look at like the slate of films that I've got upcoming, I basically try to make sure there's a decent amount of everything. So I do look for, like, I want a good amount of foreign films. I want dance scenes with black performers. I want like slow dances that are just purely conversational. And of course, I always have a good selection of classic horror because that's, you know, what made my account, and that's what I'm interested in as well. So I always do try to have a wide selection, and I have all these like and kind of like complicated rules that I keep to myself that helps me organize and plan. Like a very like simple thing that I do is look for like birthdays. So like when I'm planning for October at the moment, or like it's halfway done, and so I basically just go for the month of October and see like what birthday kind of celebrate with a dancing treat. And it's probably not the most best way to like create a selection. Like I would much prefer it if it was more linked thematically. Like if I was a better creator, I think I would do more of that. But it just makes things very easy if I just look at birthdays and fill in a certain amount and then just kind of like fill in the gaps. And I do like always try to create these, like occasionally do try to create like thematic things. That could be just something very simple, like there could be like a heavy prominence of like red for like a particular day, or maybe one day there'll be like three dancers up with ballet dancers. And yeah, I do try to create these little connections, and maybe like nobody will notice them, but it satisfies me to like curate in that way.
Yes, well, I've certainly noticed the curation that goes into the account, and I love, as you say, likening it to a gallery that has, you know, rotating exhibitions in and out. You mentioned that you had thought of it as an archive. So what do you mean by that, that you wanted it to be an archive at one point? What exactly was your goal?
Yeah, so like, I would never thought of it as an archive in the sense of preserving or anything like that. It was more of an archive as in like a resource that people could go to if they wanted to look for something very specific. So if you wanted to look up Audrey Hepburn dance scenes, then you could just maybe go to my Twitter account and you could find them all there if you just type in my username and Audrey Hepburn. But obviously, like I said, like that has changed now that I have to delete my tweets.
Yeah. And, you know, I think what you do, I would, you know, you've answered my next question, but I think what a lot of what you do clearly falls under fair use. And what you do is a mix of criticism and history and curation. Could you talk a little bit more on exactly what the pushback you've seen copyright wise on your tweets is? Like, what was the claim? What did Twitter say?
Yeah, so in 2019, I got like a succession of strikes in quite quickly. And it was mostly for clips that featured pop songs. So one of them was from Magic Mike XLL. The name was XXL.
Yeah, something like that, yeah.
And yeah, it was, I don't remember the name. It was like Joe Mangiello. He was dancing in that store and like breaking open the tutus and things like that. I don't, and yeah, like that was one of the scenes that was copyrighted. And another one was from Beyonce. And yeah, it just happened very quickly. But I also like did nothing about it. Like I got my first strike and I just didn't react to it in the way that I should have, because I should have saw it coming. And so I feel like I was at fault for that, because like it's not, like, people would like to blame Twitter for what happened, but I don't think that was the case, because I thought, I don't know how exactly they find these copyrighted clips, but I assume some sort of program that searches through Twitter and then when they see something, they strike it. And yeah, unfortunately I was a victim to that. I think it actually turned out for the better. Like, I like the way my Twitter account is now. And I like I said, that emphasis on creation. And, like, I think it suits my account to just have this select few clips at any one time. Like, I like things existing at the time they're posted. And then, and they have, like, a lifespan. And if you miss it, then that's unfortunate. But that's just the way my account goes.
I love that. That's very poetic. And I didn't know what the exact, I didn't see that you had, you know, obviously not as many tweets as for how long your account's been, but I was wondering what the precise story was behind that. And I'm wondering, you know, clearly going to your Twitter feed now is certainly a snapshot, I would imagine, to some extent, of your own viewing habits and what's preoccupying you in the moment as far as your interest in film and the different types of things that you're watching. I'm wondering, what have you learned? And it could be a million things, so you feel free to just pick one or whatever. What have you learned generally about the musical genre when you, by doing this account and by going through all this material? And I imagine you must feel so, like, close and attached to the musical. As you say, you started off kind of wanting to be this defender of the genre and to advocate for it, particularly in classical Hollywood. So what have you, just learned and taken away from this process? How has your relationship, or perhaps a better way to ask is, how has your relationship with this material deepened as a result of, you know, 5 years of posting?
I mean, I think it definitely, like, strengthened my feelings towards the musical genre. And also, like, I had very few expectations when I started the account. So I guess I learned that there's a very wide appeal to that genre of film. And just watching people dance in general, like, there's something very joyous about watching people dance. And I think that's something that everybody shares, even if they have, like, little interest in film. Like, I think, if I'm being completely honest, I think my majority of followers aren't particularly, like, interested in film in the way that probably we are. Like, they're probably, like, just casual viewers. But there's something about the musical that is just entrancing that I think captures people's imaginations. And also, it can be quite nostalgic genre, because it's probably the kind of film that maybe people watch as a kid and are introduced to as a kid, but probably don't watch as an older. But maybe my Twitter account has, like, introduced a few scenes and movies to them.
I think maybe people who aren't exposed to a lot of classical Hollywood cinema, like, I think I probably was this way before I developed a serious interest in film, like, didn't really have an appreciation for how elaborate and complex, like, the choreography for certain dances were. Like, I think of that scene that I think you've shared a couple of times with Debbie Reynolds, where she's in the football. She's, like, the football. And what is the name of that film? Is it I Love Melvin, yeah. And it's such an it's unbelievable that they're able to, like, I'd watch it in awe. And I think you always, maybe you share it, like, when it's the Super Bowl or something like that. And I imagine that must just reach so many people on that day who are there just to watch football and then see this thing. And they're like, oh my God, like, I had, like, it's such an achievement of pure athleticism. It's it must be quite wonderful and reach so many people who are just blown away by it.
Yeah, maybe. I think of that scene as like more comical than like.
Oh, it's very funny, of course. Yeah.
Yeah, I don't know. Like, I don't know really how generally my tweets reach audiences. Like, I don't know if it's mainly from my account that people see them, or is it from people sharing them. So, like, in the case of, like, that Debbie Reynolds clip, I think I hashed it. I would sometimes post to join the Super Bowl. I think I did it this year, but I did it last year. And I guess it's kind of become like a semi-annual tradition, I guess. And it's just like, I almost do it as a joke in a way. Because it's just such a weird scene And it's not like that scene itself is a joke in the context of the film as well. Like, the whole point is that she's playing a humiliating part in a humiliating sequence. So people may see it as like, oh, this is meant to be a good musical scene, but it's not. And that's the part of the joke.
Right.
So I think that gets slightly lost if you just see the scene out of context. But I do, but it is a very funny scene. I do like that scene as well. Yeah, and I don't think, like I said, like I do hashtag the Super Bowl, but I don't know like how many people really pay attention to those things sometimes.
And right.
Yeah.
I mean, that actually leads perfectly to my next question, which is that, you know, these clips, and it's something we've touched on a little bit, these clips are often isolated from the original films. So you don't get that context from, you know, I Love Melvin, and you don't know how that functions in the plot. And so you might just be like, this is an insanely weird, bizarre, hilarious scene, but also like really impressive in a way, like just from a technical aspect, like when you don't actually think about how absurd it is, like there's so many cool things like going on with it. What do you think like the impact of removing the context from the films are for these clips and people are engaging them with? Like, is there something we learn about these scenes by isolating them from the original source, or that we learn or maybe even just appreciate more by removing them from their context?
I think, well, in the context of like old Hollywood musicals, I feel a lot of them are quite isolated in themselves. Like if you transpose one Fred and Ginger musical number to another and like change around a few little things, maybe change names, stuff like that, then I feel like it could transpose quite seamlessly into another film. So like, I feel like a lot of musical numbers are designed that way to be quite isolated, like in a way that kind of like an action sequence, which can also be kind of taken out of context and just be enjoyed. I do enjoy that lack of context. Like none of my tweets have any kind of commentary or context associated with them. All I do is just write the actors that feature in them and the director and sometimes the choreographer. And I do like that strict format that I have, because I think it allows like my audience to create their own context. Like if there's like a conversation between like during a slow dance scene, then I like to think of people imagining what exactly they're talking about, or imagining what's happening in the scene, and kind of like speculate as to what precisely is happening. But I also do think it does come with like a few problems. Like I think I do like contribute to this, but there's a problem that if you isolate a scene, you can judge a film just on the scene, which is always something that I feel film Twitter can be quite guilty of. Like sometimes I see like somebody like maybe post a clip of from a film and like highlight the bad editing during this particular part. But like if you're watching in the context of film, you may not notice that bad editing because you might be like engaged with the narrative. So I think like Twitter can be quite guilty of isolating scenes and judging a film by that scene. And I'm very aware that I can contribute to that. And I do sometimes worry about that a little bit, because I hope that people don't judge a film just on the scenes that I post. Like I'm very cautious. Like I do try to be uncynical. Like that's a very important thing about my account. Like, so I post like clips from all sorts of films, a lot of clips from films that I don't particularly enjoy. And like, I don't do it to hate on that film. I want to kind of give respect to everything I post.
That makes a lot of sense. And, you know, I think one of the things, like I mentioned before, the other podcast I do, the Video Essay Podcast, deals a lot of you know, works that, you know, have found footage and reappropriated footage. And one of the things we talk about when we reappropriate footage is that, on the one hand, it carries with it all of the associations of the film or television show or whatever that it's from. So when we watch one of your clips, you know, if we've seen Swing Time. We know the plot, we know the theme, we know the body of work of the characters, but at the same time, by isolating it in the way that you do, by cutting it, by editing it, by, you know, selecting that, you know, at, well, what's now two, a little over 2 minutes, but before it was 30 seconds. By doing that, you are also creating something new and giving us a new way to look at it. So when I feel often when I watch your tweets and your videos, I take it as an opportunity to kind of, as you say, not judge the film as a whole and not even really think about the film as a whole, but to really think about the dancing, which is what it's about. So therefore, the clips for me become so much more about movement and about performance and about how the camera is capturing the way that people are moving. And so in a sense, I find your Twitter account to be very liberating in that way, and that it's giving us a new way to see material that we haven't seen, but also to see classic films that we've seen 100 times, you know?
Yeah. I like that idea of tapping into that nostalgic factor and resharing clips from maybe people's childhood, or just like a clip that probably they haven't seen in a long time. But also like the idea of celebrating probably like dancers that probably aren't as well known, like Eleanor Powell, who's in a lot of films like Honolulu and a lot of the Broadway Melody films. And I think she's like one of the best dancers out there, like in all of film history. And like a lot of people always comment that she's kind of like underrated. So I hope with my account that I've like spotlighted her and like introduced her to at least a few more people. Maybe they don't always recognize her name or always remember, but hopefully they do.
Yeah, no, and your account for what it's worth has definitely led me to many films and to many Wikipedia pages and searching through things. So it's definitely an invaluable resource in that way. You know, nearing up on the end of our conversation here, I do have one other question, and that is, earlier you mentioned, you know, creating a GIF of Lauren Bacall and To Have and Have Not. And of course, that's not a musical. I mean, music plays a part in that film. Hoagy Carmichael's in it playing the piano, and, you know, she sings and stuff. So music is important to that film, but it's not a musical, and there's not a Gene Kelly dance number in it, of course. So when did you start to really... I mean, the name is Dancer on Film, so it's not exclusive to musicals. But when did you start to capture dance more broadly, right? Because I think sometimes it could just be a heavy action movie that has someone dancing for a little bit, and sometimes you'll tweet a clip or a GIF of that. When did you decide to expand and why? Because I think it really offers a fresh way of interpreting dance in non-musical movies and what that means.
Yeah, I think it was something I considered, I think, straight from the beginning, to be honest. Like because, as I said, because I wanted an archive in the beginning, like, I was very focused on just posting as many different dance scenes as possible. And that meant, like, very rarely revisiting things. So that means that I have to just look at all genres possible. Like, obviously, it's like Hollywood musicals is my go-to because it's just very easy. Like, I almost don't have to give it a thought. Like, I know if I pick up a Hollywood musical, there'll be a dance scene. I know that I can use it. But like, when you're trying to board out, you don't have to give more thoughts as to what films have dance scenes and what doesn't. Like, sometimes you have to like keep a mental note. Like, if you're watching a film that, oh, there's a dancing in this, I must like make a mental note, and I'll try to get back to it later, or even like straight away. So yeah, so like I've always kept that in mind, and I've always tried to like watch a wide variety of films. Like, that's like, in, personally, I think that's important to me. Like, I always try to discover new things and watch new things. So I'm always happy, like, if I'm watching something really obscure, to find a dance scene in it, because I know I can use it. Like, even if, like, nobody else has heard of this film, like, I'm still happy to celebrate it and hopefully, like, it could make that film more well known.
Well, I know, as I've said, you know, it's such a noble cause that you're doing, and the work that you do does not go unnoticed or unappreciated. I know. Anthony, thank you so much for taking the time to join On Your Screen and to chat with me about your work. And thank you again for all the work that you do for the film community online. It's very much appreciated. So thank you.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you for having me, and it's been a lot of fun.